And if you've got your Bibles, we're going to be in Matthew 6. You can begin getting there. I'm kind of helping in the continuation of your series of through the Sermon on the Mount. And so I'd love for you to get into Matthew chapter 6. And I'm going to pray in just a minute. But before I do, I think today I just want to acknowledge, obviously, this weekend, July 4th weekend. First of all, thank you for being here, not being on the lake. Praise the Lord. You know, shows you really love Jesus, right? So we're thankful that you're here. And I just, obviously, today really fits into the theme of the weekend because we're talking about how to have freedom in Christ. How to have freedom in Christ. And what does it look like for that? And obviously, we're celebrating that this weekend. So maybe this weekend as you're, and tomorrow as you're celebrating the freedom we have as a country, would you pause for a moment to thank Christ for the freedom you have over from spiritual darkness and really from the evil one, and you have life in Christ. And so I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to bless the preaching of his word, and then we're going to dive into Matthew 6. So let's do that now. Lord, again, just thank you for all you're doing in this church, all you've done in the past week. I mean, and even before that, I'm thankful for just what has been a work of VBS, just a whole work of the next generation. I'm thankful for students in this service and in the last service that have already stepped up to the challenge to lead out in worship, to be the leaders of worship for this congregation. They would lead the way, and us old people would kind of get on board, like, oh, great, yeah, they're inspiring us to worship our King who so deserves it. And so I'm thankful for the zeal of our students, and I pray that you would just continue to foster that into greater spiritual maturity. Father, obviously, thank you for even the privilege it is to worship together, to have a freedom of worship that was bought for us and fought for and all those things. And so we remember that this weekend. And it's really a microcosm of the greatest freedom of all, which is Christ and in Christ and freedom from sin and death. And so, Father, I pray that you would just continue to help us see you and worship you for who you are and for what you deserve. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, Matthew 6, and we're going to see kind of the motivation of this message that Jesus is teaching is really shifting the hearts of the people from worry or anything else that they focus on and shifting on to what is true worship. How do you fully worship God? How do you walk in obedience to Christ? And I think Jesus makes it very clear in chapter 6, you'll see this text is kind of a tag onto the last text, but ultimately Christ is making much of himself. He's put a dichotomy between the world and the kingdom, and he continues to reiterate the differences between those worlds. And so you're going to see, let's read it together in Matthew 6, and I want to just read it to you. I'm going to read the text in its entirety, but I think you're going to see Jesus continuing to make the argument of kingdom over the world. So let's read it. Starting in verse 25, says this, "Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, or about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. In verse 33, you can underline it, highlight it. This is kind of the high point of the Sermon on the Mount. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. God bless the reading of your word. So when the LifePoint elders came and asked me if I would preach this Sunday, I jumped at the chance. You know, I'm here in town for a little while. I preach camp, whatever. I leave Thursday to preach some camps in Kentucky, and looking forward to that. But they asked me if I would come on July 3rd and preach, and I jumped at the chance. And then I said, hey, okay, tell me what text we're reading. And they told me Matthew 6. And I said, of course it's Matthew 6. And I just kind of laughed at God, really, because the things that have been going on in my life in Matthew 6 are just hand in glove in a lot of ways. And I want to kind of tell you that story. Like, at the beginning of this year, my family walked through probably the hardest thing that we've walked through in our lives. This year has been it's been the toughest year yet. I mean, maybe you don't know my story. So I used to pastor here for 14 years. I started in student ministry, and that was great. 6 years, I think, in student ministry, and then God was calling me to pastor, and I got the opportunity to do that, to kind of plant and pastor in Bangkok for 3 years with my family, and we lived there from 2012 to 15, and then God was again calling me to the States to pastor, and so we started the Riverdale campus. Plant and pastored it was Burrow and then Riverdale. And we planted and pastored that campus for 4 years. And then God was stirring my heart to be a lead pastor. And, I wrestled with that and talked with Pat a whole lot about that. We prayed through that, and God was very clear that this is what he wanted us to do. So about 2.5 years ago, we moved to South Florida to be the lead pastor of a church. And for 2.5 years, really, God was moving. It was incredible. We were growing. The church was growing during COVID, which was unheard of. It was like 130% of people post-COVID. When every other church was like, these are our pre-COVID numbers, we're like, we're way more than we were pre-COVID. Like, God was blessing it. And then God was, we were seeing people come to know Christ. And we were seeing people be baptized. And, we got to baptize more people than the church had historically done in years. And we saw that in like 6 months. And then financially, the growth of the church was phenomenal. And God just had his hand on it. And then we came here at Christmas break, as we typically do, spend time with Jen's family and my family, and spent a couple of weeks here, and then we went back at the beginning of this year, and it kind of all hit the fan. And it went sideways. Long story short, I ended up submitting my resignation to that church towards the end of January, and it was the toughest few months of our lives. And you want to talk about when the scripture is saying, do not be anxious, and I'm telling my soul, do not be anxious. You know what I'm when the Lord is saying to you, I got this, and I'm trying to be like, I'm trying to believe that, God. I'm trying to hang on to that. I've never felt the Psalms more than I have this year. I almost believe you almost need to walk through something hard before you're allowed to read the Psalms, because they come alive in a whole different way. But I was reading Psalm 43, and where it says, why are you downcast, O my soul? And I felt that. And then I walked into the next line, which the psalmist speaks over his own soul. It says, hope in God. Hope in God, soul. Would you hope in God? Why are you so anxious? Why are you worried about food? Why are you worried about what you're going to wear? Of course I would have to preach Matthew 6 here today. And then we went through this process of healing and just really just growth and really affirmation of God's calling on our lives and what he's doing in us and what he wants to do in us. And so we begin to pray about, okay, God, what's next? What do we do? What are you calling us to? Do we just apply to another church? Or what do we do, God? What do you want us to do? And God just continue to move in us towards church planting. You thought it was stressful before. Now, church planning, I had kind of done some of that with my experience with LifePoint, right? Bangkok campus and then Riverdale. We kind of church started. And then, but then this is a whole different ball game because I start getting into things and it's like, there's this, like the people side of it, I feel like LifePoint really prepared me for. But then there's this whole other side where it's like all this legal language and stuff, and I'm kind of looking at it like I got three eyeballs, got constitution and bylaws and 501c3s and fundraising and where are we going to meet and who's, you know, who do we have any speakers? I don't know, all these different things, and it's just beginning to well up in me, like, I don't know if we can do this. God, I don't know if we can do this. Of course I'd have to preach Matthew 6. Well, I just have to constantly hear the command of the Lord of do not be anxious and constantly hear the command of Christ, but seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. So I'm here to say that, you know, some of you are here and you're walking through it or you've walked through it. And, you know, maybe you came in here and you're very, yeah, I have to angst just about being in a church because you maybe feel like don't nobody gets you or you're in a dark place that nobody understands. I do. I've walked it. And God's been faithful even in the valleys. Or maybe you're in here and you got a task, a mountain ahead of you, and you don't know how you're going to conquer that mountain. I'm walking it. Not perfectly by any means. But I know that God is faithful and he will see us through. So of course we're gonna be in Matthew 6. We all got some kind of anxiety, right? We all got some kind of worry. I mean, you know, and this is what worry is. I mean, it's, you know, the word anxiety or worry is it's really just a care about a particular thing. Now the difference is, because we, you know, Jesus, I want you to be understand that when he tells us not to be anxious, he doesn't say don't care about things. Right, it's not Bob Marley or whatever, don't worry, be happy, where you just kind of walk through life like you don't give a rip about anything. That's not what don't be anxious means. Jesus cared very deeply about things. He cared so deeply about the worship of God in the temple that he overthrew tables. He cared very deeply. So this isn't like, okay, if I just zone out and don't care about anything, then I won't have anxiety. That is not what is saying here. The difference between worry, the caring that is a genuine caring and anxiety is you take this thing that you worry about and you're either going to stress over it, worry about it, have anxiety because of it, or you're going to be dependent upon Christ, trust him, have more faith, and worship him. So with everything in life, rebellious kids, job loss, where's money coming from, gas is too high, all the things, right? We look at all the things and we could wring our hands and stress out. We've got decisions to make. We're either going to take that thing and we're going to worry or we're going to worship. And that's the beauty of Jesus. The scripture tells us to cast all of our anxieties upon him. Why? Because he cares for you. Because he cares for you. And then you have to wrestle with the fact that the very command given to us is do not be anxious. That's a command. It's not a suggestion. He's saying, don't be anxious. Don't worry. Cast your anxieties upon the Lord who cares for you. And so I hope that, again, by dissecting the text this morning, that it will lead us away from worry and anxiety to more worship of Jesus. And that's really the first point I want to kind of wrestle with is the worry that we see in the world. Again, there is legitimate concerns for things. And then there's sinful anxiety. Now, our problem is that line, sometimes we don't know when we cross it. Right, where we worry so much and then all of a sudden we can't sleep at night we have trouble breathing, we have trouble, we have panic attacks or whatever, and we don't know where that line is and where we've crossed the line. So a healthy response to us is to, yes, care, but immediately begin to cast that onto the Lord. You know, the English word for worry is derived from a German word that means to choke out or to strangle. And that's exactly what worry does, right? It chokes out life and joy and happiness from our life. If I had, you know, some, if you're like me, you will be driving home. You'll be in your car. Hopefully you're by yourself. Otherwise it'd freak people out. But you're driving home and you're having arguments, imaginary arguments. If they say this, I'm going to say this. Or if they do this, I'm going to do this. And 90% of the arguments that you have in your car never happen. Am I the only one? That's worry. That's stress. That's anxiety. How much better for us to, I mean, we're going to think about those things anyway. Were those things going to be bowling around in our head anyway? This isn't a you have a spiritual amnesia and forget all the problems. That's not the antidote to worry. What the antidote to worry is, you take all those things and you say, hey, I'm mulling them over anyway. I'm going to gripe about them in my car anyway. How about I turn all that complaining and that stress and anxiety and begin to turn it into handing it to Jesus and say, hey, this is yours. I've got this issue. I need you to show up. I've got this worry about my kids, and I can speak at them till I'm blue in the face, but I can't change their hearts. I'm stressed about how we're going to make ends meet this month. God, your word says you are a provider. Would you do that? And so you begin to stop internalizing your own worries and start to cast them upon to Christ, because he cares for you. He cares for you. He loves his people. He loves his children. I think it's important too, to notice that the text starts with the word therefore. There's that adage that says, if you see a therefore, you have to ask, what's it therefore? The therefore is connecting the previous passage that you talked about last week. Last week, I went to the Riverdale campus, sat under Kyle's preaching, love what God is doing through Kyle going, love what God is doing through the Riverdale campus there. But there were three points. There were two kingdoms, right? There were two visions, and there were two masters. If you remember the message from last week, and it was a great message. And what is continuing to happen through this text is Jesus is pitting the world versus the kingdom. You can't serve God and money. You will love one and betray the other. He's talking about where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Your treasure is not going to be in these two different places. You know, so he's linking that passage with this passage about do not be anxious about your life. Matter of fact, theologian, pastor, he's going to be with the Lord now, Martin Lloyd-Jones is his name. He says that there's an intentionality to who Jesus is talking about last week, that he would be talking to more of the affluent crowd that has gathered around him last week, and that this week's message about worry and anxiety is more towards those that aren't affluent, the poor, the average income individuals. And, so he makes the point, it's two points towards the affluent and the unfortunate. Now, to the rich, as you talked about last week, and hear me, I would categorize most of us in that vein, right? If you lay us on the backdrop of the entirety of the world, we are very rich. We have two vehicles. My family has two vehicles. That puts us leaps and bounds beyond most of the world. So the rich, and he's beginning to speak to the rich, and he's telling them where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. He's really challenging them that even if you're wealthy, the wealthy have the tendency to be gripped by getting more. I got to get more. I got to save what I got. I'm looking at my 401k. I'm getting stressed out, and beginning to try to grab and claw and store up more. How can I grow my net worth? How can I get more? I find it true. It always rings true that the great theologian, Biggie Smalls, when he says, "Mo' money, mo' problems." Doesn't it? I mean, the more things you own, the more things on you. And so Jesus is speaking to those people and saying, hey, you're stressing out, but really there's a kingdom. And there's a kingdom to put all of your treasure into. And if your treasure is there, your heart will be there. And then he speaks to the poor, because I think the poor equally is very dangerous temptation. But kind of the same vein is they stress over what they wish they had. If I could just win the lotto, you know, if I could just get more, get a better job, or find a different place, and so you're consumed with, we don't have, wish we had. And what comes with that is a lot of stress, anxiety. Now, let me be clear, Jesus is not reducing our problems. Our problems are our problems. You got to eat, got to have clothes. You got to deal with the things of life. He's not reducing those problems. He's just teaching us that there is something higher than our problems, and he's teaching us a greater trust and dependency upon him, even with those problems, that we would cast all of our anxieties upon the Lord who cares for us. And then Jesus, who is the best illustrator. He begins to talk about the birds and the lilies. Now, 3 or 4 years ago, I got to go with LifePoint. Some of you, we went to Israel together, and we go to the place where Jesus is going to teach, where he taught the Sermon on the Mount. And you sit there on the side of the hill. You know, we bypass, you know, the Catholics put a church on everything. So we go around that. We don't go in there. And we sit on the side of the Mount, and we're looking over. We see the Sea of Galilee, and we see just the field. And then you see flowers. And you hear birds. And you're just picturing Jesus said, hey guys, look at the flowers. Look at how they're clothed. And I'm telling you that Solomon, in all his splendor, doesn't compare to these flowers. How much more valuable are you? And do you see the birds? Who feeds them? I mean, they don't store up things. They get a new worm every day or something. They're always flying around and figuring out how it is they're going to eat and what are they going to find to eat. But yet God takes care of them. How much more valuable are you? See, this is a lesser than to greater than argument that Jesus is making. He's saying to us, you, first and foremost, are made in the very image of God. You've been given a soul. You have a conscience. You've been made like God in many ways. We are not God, but you've been made like him in many ways. And God cares for you. If he takes care of the bird and the flower that are not made in the image of God, how much more will he take care of you? Secondarily, for the believer, if Christ laid down his life for you, will he not also take care of these things? Paul makes that argument to us. He says, if Jesus laid down his life, will he not also give us blessing and be with us and take care of us? So it's a lesser than greater than argument. Jesus is imploring us to understand, because that's what happens with worry and stress and anxiety, right? The room just kind of closes in on us. Well, I don't know if we're going to make it. I don't know if this is going to happen. I don't know if this is all going to work out. It's all up to me. I don't know. And the room just continues to kind of close in on us. And God is saying, do you not know who you are? Do you not know that I made you? Do you not know that I loved you before the foundations of the world? Do you not know that I proved that love by sending my own son and slaying him on your behalf so that you might have life forever with me? Do you not know these things? And this is the point of Jesus' sermon, to get us to understand who he is, which leads me to verse 33 again, and we're going to see kind of the the point of freedom in the kingdom. But verse 33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the, what things? Clothes, food, life, all these things will be added to you. What Jesus is making a point here, he's not saying that those things don't matter, but he's saying those things are secondary to kingdom things. And the kind of church that is going to see the world turned upside down, the kind of church that's going to live a kingdom-minded life, the kind of church that's going to see the least in the kingdom become great, the servant of all become ruler of all, like the kind of kingdom has this upside-down kingdom, of the kind of people that say, above all things, I seek kingdom. I seek Christ. I turn my eyes to him. I build my house on the rock of the confession of Christ so that when the storms come, it cannot knock me over. And so we trust Christ all the more. You know, one of the things you see with people who walk through addiction recovery and is you can't just say no and cut something out of your life. You also have to then replace that with something else. You have to replace it with, and you know, depends on what rehab facility you're a part of or what kind of program you go through. The good ones, I know S2L and things that this church partners with, replaces it and points people to seeking Christ. So it's not just saying no to getting this out of your heart and life, but it's also putting in Christ, kingdom things. You'll see this too in a lot of folks who've walked through recovery is they'll replace addiction with other kind of hobbies. I've walked with people who've replaced it with gaming or something else. It's just got to be replaced with that. This is true too when we're fighting sin in our own life. Some of you are fighting some really strong sins that you have been dealing with for years and you just can't get victory over those things. I would say to you, it's not just saying no to that, but it's also saying yes to Christ. I want more of him. I want to seek more of him. I want to put my eyes on him. I want to fill myself with things that are of him. So replacing. And I think that's what Jesus is saying here is that you just can't say, don't be anxious, okay? Let's walk out of here. That's the message. Don't be anxious. I'm going to work real hard not to be anxious. I'm going to be anxious about not being anxious. That's not the message. The message is higher than that. It's not just slap your hand, don't do it. The message is there's something greater. There's something greater. And your eyes get on the waves and of the storm of your life, but Jesus is saying to you, there's something greater. So it's not just don't be anxious, but it's also set your eyes to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Behold him and you'll become like him. Put your eyes on him. Put your heart towards him. Everything. We say everything is yours. So it's no to this, but it's yes to the greater promises in us, to us in Christ. So it's a replacement kind of deal there. Now, one of the nights of camp, the second night of camp, we were walking through Isaiah 26, and particularly on the second night, we dealt with 26:8, which says this, O Lord, we wait for you, your name and your renown, or remembrance in the ESV, are the desire of our souls. Your name and your renown are the desire of our souls. And one of the things we talked about is that if you have no desire for Christ, if competing desires are greater than your desire for Christ, then you need to begin to wonder and question, am I in fact in Christ? That evidence of Christ reforming a life, converting a life, changing a life, saving a life is that your desires completely change. First John goes over this a bunch, like that you used to love sin, Christ changed you. Not that you don't do it anymore, but you hate that you do it. You used to mock God and his ways and the scriptures, Christ saves you. Now the commands of God are not a burden to you. You used to mock Christians and Facebook rant about whatever. You've seen a lot of that probably in the last couple weeks. But God converts you and changes you, and now you love this crazy bunch of people. God changes your desires. And this is exactly what Jesus is saying in the Sermon on the Mount. He's saying, seek the kingdom first. And those who are in Christ, this is what we want to do. I'll read you another one. You've already, I don't know when you preached it, maybe last summer, but Matthew 5, 6 said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. This is always a very compelling scripture to me because I ask myself the question, do I hunger and thirst for righteousness? I'm hungering for the coming barbecue in the days ahead. Do I hunger? I have a longing. Do I have an emptiness if I don't have the righteousness of Christ? And the promise here is that those who hunger for it will be satisfied. I'm telling you, I think the truth rings out that you are as godly as you want to be. And that stings me because I want to be more godly than I am. And I know that if I want to be more godly, you know, then it is, you know, I come in and hunger and thirst more for him and he will satisfy. And so the things that compete for my affections and draw me away from hungering and thirsting for him, I know I could be more like him if I set my face to him, submit to him, cast all my anxieties upon him. I think I heard it said this week that there are really three kinds of people in the world. There are those that don't seek God. They know they don't seek God. They're not trying to seek God. You know, in the coming judgment, they will be on the outside looking in to the Christ's salvation. They don't seek God. Second kind of people are those that seek God, but not first. And I find these to be the most miserable of people. Anytime you try to play both sides of the street, you get hit by the bus. And so which leads me to the third kind of person, which is those people that seek God first. We put him first. Highest, not just the highest priority, but the center of all we are and all we do and all we think about. We seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given us to us. And so I think if you're going to boil it down, you're looking, the emphasis of today's message, the emphasis of what Jesus wants us to do is to look at him. If Jesus was up here and he was putting a bottom line on this screen and he was saying, hey, this is the point of the Sermon on the Mount, it's look at me. Look to Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his goodness and grace. Look in the eyes of Christ, the author and perfecter of your faith. Look in the one who you can cast all your anxieties upon. Why? Because he cares for you. It's hard for us to be anxious when we realize who Jesus is. It's hard for us to continue to grip our worry when we realize what the kingdom is about. It's hard for us to just mull over the problems that we have when we realize there's coming a day, and that day is not very far from now, when all of us who've been found in Christ and have confessed Christ will be standing around the throne of God singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy of praise is our King. And the problems of yesterday and the problems of tomorrow will be burned up. How then can we not continue to say, oh Lord, here's my anxieties. You care for me and I'll be with you forever. What a great God. What a great Savior. What a great Lord. I think what we also see here, and I want to be very clear on, is Jesus says, makes the promise that he's going to meet our needs. He doesn't say once. He's not promising you flat screens, but he's talking about your clothes and your food, and I'm going to care for you, he says. It reminds me of the story I heard of the young missionary years ago who was going off to the mission field, and he's getting on the boat to travel to this foreign land. And on this, before he goes, he's walked to the boat with one of his buddies who happened to be wealthier. And so he's sending him off, and the wealthy friend hands to the young missionary. He says, hey, here's an envelope. If it ever gets down to you can't get your needs met, I want you to open this. Young missionary says, great, pockets it and heads on the boat. 12 years later, the young missionary comes back home and he's greeted by that friend again, and they embrace and just great love for one another. And the young missionary pulls out the envelope, still sealed. And he looks him in the eyes and he says, there was never a moment that God didn't meet our needs. Church, I'm here to tell you, God is going to meet our needs. He's going to take care of us. He's going to take care of you. He's going to provide for you. He's going to draw you closer to himself spiritually. He's going to work in your children's lives. He's going to move. We just need to continue to pour our hearts to him, trust him, turn our worry to worship of our great God. I'm reminded, too, of Corey Ten Boom. If you're not familiar with Corey Ten Boom, you probably should be. You obviously didn't do your like school readings, you know, whatever. And but Corey Ten Boom obviously was a Christian during Nazi Germany. She was hiding Jews in her home. And that would probably be a situation that would provide a lot of stress, a lot of anxiety. You can just imagine and picture the shuffling of feet outside of her home, the voices of guards gathered around, the searching of her home to see if there in fact are Jews hiding in her home, the hush of those in hiding, say, don't make a sound. It's pretty pressure packed. One of the things that Corey Ten Boom says, she says, look around and be distressed. Look inside and be depressed. Look at Jesus and be at rest. There's rest in Christ. Maybe you're in here today and you don't know him. You've never bowed your knee to him. You've kind of encountered the service, or you're watching online saying, what is happening? Everything's crazy here. I would say to you, you first need your heart changed to understand the things of God. Maybe you thought that this was a list of moral things for you to add to your thing. All right, if I go to church more, if I read my Bible more, if I pray more, but if your heart hasn't been changed, those things will just produce more legalism in you and more death. Your desires have to be, your heart has to be changed first. So bow your knee to him. The good news of the gospel is that we were dead in our sins, but God, being rich in mercy, laid down the life of his son so that we might have life in Christ. So you come to Christ and be saved. And then God will move in such a way to free you from your anxieties and fears and worries. I told you at the beginning of this thing that, we walked through a hard time. And there was a particular song that I'm going to read to you the lyrics of that song. And I just want you to hear them as I close today. I just want you to hear them, because this song was powerful in my own life to, again, walk through some tough days, some tough nights, some tough weeks, some tough months. This song has been even more precious to me as I'm looking at the mountain before me, saying, how are we going to climb that mountain? I don't know, but God knows. And here the song says this: be still, my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, he faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your heavenly friend, through thorny ways, leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul. Your God will undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul. The waves and winds still know his voice who ruled them when he lived below. Be still, my soul. When dearest friends depart and all is darkened in the veil of tears, then you will better know his love, his heart, who comes to soothe your sorrows and your fears. Be still, my soul. Your Jesus can repay from his own fullness all he takes away. And be still, my soul. The hour is hastening on when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, and sorrow forgot, and love's purest joys restored. Be still, my soul. When change and tears are past, all safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. Father, help us to remember you moved heaven and earth to save a people unto yourself. How will you not also meet our needs? We have all we need in Christ. How will we stress about the things of today? You've been so faithful to us in the past. How will you not also be faithful in the future? God, help our unbelief. And at the root of anxiety and worry, that's exactly what it is. It's an unbelief. Help us to trust that our God, faithful is his name, faithful he will ever be. And even if we're to suffer, even if we're to be wanting, even if we're to lose our lives, the truth remains that our God is King. And you are sovereign and you are good. And the storms that come, come only from your hand. So you will accomplish your will and purpose in our life through every one of them. So God, be worshiped, be praised. Be praised in the trust of casting and throwing our anxieties upon you and knowing that you're not distant, but you care for us. You're not far away, but you hear us and you answer and you move and you love. May we walk our days in the goodness of God, not in the worry of the world. Be worshiped by your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.